next to him. I was really down. I was really down. The devil really had me. But God's mercy kept me. I'm here tonight because of God's mercy. Come on now, just thank him. Just thank him.
Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We welcome each and everyone who has joined us in service today. It means the world to us that you came to worship with us. As we continue in this new way of doing business and to avoid any interruption, we ask that you check your phones and your devices and please place them on mute. If you are actively taking part in the service, that is, if you are singing, reading, or taking part in the children's message, after you would have finished, please return your phones and devices back to me. Amen.
Amen.
Our opening hymn is Come Thou Font of Every Blessing. Hymn number 400. Come Thou Font of Every Blessing. Hymn 400 that is going to be sung today by Yvonne Stewart Amu.
Come the fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, Mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by thy help am come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it from thy courts above. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Amen.
Amen. Reverend Pickett, going to lead us in the opening prayer.
Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this opportunity to continue worshiping you. We thank you for these virtual spaces that allow us to continue to gather together as community. We pray that in this time of worship that you would take our hearts and seal them. Seal them for the work that you have called us to do. Seal them for the purpose that you have instilled in each and every one of us. We thank you for your presence that is felt in this space. We thank you for the community that is Bethany United Methodist Church, for Pastor Phillips, and for all who have come together to make this opportunity possible. Meet us now in this virtual space, in your spirit, so that we may be reminded that no matter where we are, you are with us. You are our God, and we are your people. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Our call to worship. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call on his name. Make known his deeds among the people.
Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wonderful works.
Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually.
Remember the wonderful work he has done, his miracles and judgment he uttered.
We come to give thanks, to praise and to remember his glorious work. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen. Let everything that have breath praise the Lord. And at this time, we're going to call on Brother Alfred Power to bring our praise offering in the beauty of holiness. In the beauty of holiness, by Alfred Power.
Come, let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Give him the honor, give him the praise. Come, let us worship the Lord, let's give him the praise. Come, let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Give him the honor, give him the praise. Come, let us worship the Lord, let's give him the praise. Worship him. Worship him. Give my God the glory. Give my God the praise. Worship him. Worship him. Come, let us worship the Lord. Let's give him the praise. Come, let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Give him the honor, give him the praise. Come, let us worship the Lord, let's give him the praise. Come, let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Give him the honor, give him the praise. Come, let us worship the Lord, let's give him the praise. Worship him, worship him. Give my God the glory, give my God the praise. Worship him. Worship him. Come, let us worship the Lord. Let's give him the praise.
Amen. 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 Give God thanks for the gift of sound. Now it's time for our prayer of confession. In this people, God, in whom we live and move and have our being. You know us through and through. You know the many choices we face each day. We choose between right and wrong. We choose between greater and lesser evil. We choose what will be important to us in life. More often, we choose what is comfortable for us and what is expedient to us, ignoring your call to do your will at all times. We place condition on your calling. We follow if it's convenient. We will serve you only if it doesn't upset the apple cart in our lives. We sigh at making sacrifices of our time, of making commitment in your service. We divulge ourselves in excuses. Forgive us, God. Keep us honest with ourselves and others. Amen.
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 Now it's time for personal confession. The Bible tells us, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But here the good news. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of all sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So let us take this time and reflect about the things that we have done that was not pleasing to God, but we know his word tells us if we repent of it, God is able and just to forgive us. So let's take this moment. Thank you. Amen. Now hear these words of assurance. If the Son set you free, you are free indeed. Moreover, now the nature of God is in you. And most importantly, we are filled with the Holy Spirit. So we just want to say thanks be to God. Thanks be to God for sending his Son, Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God that we have this opportunity where we can call upon the name of God, repent of our sins, and know that we are free. And just as children who are free, let us now come and say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. But deliver us from all evil, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now we're going to call on Crystal Vernon to read for us the scripture. Crystal.
Grace and peace, Bethany. The scripture, the Old Testament reading will be taken from Exodus chapter 1, verse 8 through chapter 2, verse 10. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase and, in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore, they set taskmakers over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom and Ramses, for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in all tasks that they imposed on them. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of them was named Sifra and the other Puah, "When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on their birthstool, if it is a boy, kill him, but if it is a girl, she shall live." But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this and allowed the boys to live?" The midwife said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them." So God dealt with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every boy that is born to the Hebrews, you shall throw in the Nile, but you shall let every girl live." Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son. And when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came to bathe down at the river. While her attendants walked beside the river, she saw a basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrew children," she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse a child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses, because she said, "I drew him out of the water." The gospel reading will be taken from Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 to 20. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do the people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do they say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. And now it's time for the children's message. We're going to ask Bree Morgan Williams. She's going to be singing "Jesus Loved the Little Children." After she has finished, the message is going to be brought to us today by Alicia Grant. So Bree, welcome.
Come on, let's go.
Hi. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
You sure it's on?
Yeah, it's on.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, my Bethany family, those of us on Zoom, and who called in. It's very nice to see everyone today.
Make
sure I can see everyone. One second. Okay, so thank you, Bree, for that singing. If you are a child, teenagers also are included. I would love for you to say hello, just so I can get a notion of who is speaking with us this morning, and I want to be able to greet all children on the call. So, yes, yeah, say hello. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm good.
Awesome. Hi, Shanika.
Hey.
Hi, Shanika.
Stop breathing.
Okay. All right, so we have a lot of friends on the call today. So I know it's been a while since we've all been able to meet and talk in person, but this is the nature of our lifestyles right now, and I don't think it'll be forever, but it's an adjustment, and I think that Bethany has been doing an awesome job with keeping us connected, so at least we get to talk on this platform. I want one child to say their name and let me know how your summer has been going.
It was good.
Can you tell me your name? Who said it was good?
My name is Aiden.
Hi, Aiden. What was so good about your summer?
I had a lot of fun. I got to spend time with my
family. Okay, that sounds great. Another child, how was your summer?
My summer was good.
Okay, what made your summer so good?
Summer was good. We got to go shopping with my aunt.
Okay,
that's good.
Right.
It was a book half, but it was raining a lot.
Okay, can I ask who's speaking? Okay. Thank you, Judea. Awesome. All right. My service is not that good, so I'm going to try to work with as possible. All right. So I heard people's summers are good. They got time to spend with their families, do a lot of things that, you know, which summer should be about. So I know that many of us are going to school. Some of you are actually starting next week. Is anyone in the call starting school next week?
Yes.
Who said yes? Aiden?
Caden?
Okay. How do you feel about school starting next week?
I feel okay. I met my friends and I have new teachers now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you're excited about school, right, Caden?
Yes.
Okay. I know some charter schools are doing hybrid, so some of them may be going in and then coming out. Do you know if you're going into the building or are you just staying virtually?
Virtually.
Okay, okay. How does that make you feel?
I don't know.
Okay, take your time. You don't know? How did it end for you? Like, did you adjust okay to being on a computer every single day for school? Or was it like, oh my gosh, here we go again?
I adjusted.
Okay. That's very, very good to hear. Anyone else? How do you feel about going back to school?
I feel a little scared. Mm-hmm.
How do you feel school scared?
Corona.
Oh, the corona. I think you might be staying home, Didia. So you won't have to worry too much about the coronavirus. But in all, we are going back to school. We had a summer and Alicia Grant, I am looking for a school psychology position. So if anyone knows of anything, you know, that's, I would love to do that. So I'm not really scared. I do have a lot of faith in God. And I know in the past we've spoken about our relationship with God. So I want to know if any one of us have been actually praying or talking to God, whether we say good morning, thank you. Have any of you been keeping up with that?
Yes.
Yes, and how have you been keeping up with it, Caden, excuse me.
When I wake up, I thank God for giving me a new day. And when I eat food, I say my prayer to thank him for my food. And then when I sleep, I say my prayer again to make sure that he can protect me while I'm sleeping.
That's very beautiful to hear. So your relationship with God seems to be continuing. Very awesome. How about like when you're scared, do you communicate with him then?
Yes.
Yeah. So I know some of us have mixed emotions about returning to school and we haven't been able to see a lot of our friends. But the Bible tells us that once we have faith in God, he will take care of us. Specifically, Hebrews 11, verse 1 says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the connection of things not seen. So although we don't know what exactly the school year will entail, we know that God loves us, and once we believe in him first, we don't have to worry about what the school year looks like, who we're going to see, who we can't see. We just know that God will always take care of us when we believe in him. So I always tell you guys that even though you guys are young, that doesn't mean you can't have a relationship with God. That doesn't mean you can't talk to him. That just very well so means that you are a person who he created, and he wants to see you flourish. He wants you to prosper. And as you continue to believe in him, he will always take care of us. Although we may not understand everything that's taking place, this is a platform for you to heavily rely on him now and forevermore. So let us pray together. Dear God, thank you for waking us up this morning. We ask that as the summer comes to a close, we continue to talk to you and build a relationship with you. We know that school and summer and just the climate of the world has changed for some time now. And we ask that you continue to intervene in our lives. May you keep those who are sick well. May you look over our families, our friends, and the homeless people all over the world. We ask for understanding, God, during this time. And as we continue to grow, let us grow with you. In his name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, boys and girls. Amen.
Love tonight.
Amen.
Bree? And these, and now for our announcement. Please be reminded of the food program ministry, which continues to offer groceries on Tuesdays between 12:30 and 2:30 p.m. All who are in need are invited, the community as well as our congregants. Do spread the word to people who you know is, whom you know may need the help. This week, we will not be having our customary Bible study and prayer sessions on Wednesday. We will resume the following week, September the 9th. Also, this is a gentle reminder that the customary sacrificial offering for Women's Day are still expected, even though that event has been rescheduled. You can submit this in the same manner you choose to send your tithes. After a few week break, the virtual youth gathering will resume this Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. via Zoom. If you have a teenager who is not yet part of this gathering, we would love to have them included. So do let Sister Litchmore know. Do continue to hold Sister Janet Cummins in your prayers. She was hospitalized again last week. Prayers are also being asked for Sister Florence Simon, who is having a severe health challenge. Today, we would like to officially welcome Reverend Dustin Pickett as our spiritual leader for today. Reverend Pickett is no stranger to us and blessed us with a powerful word at our 130th anniversary celebration. Reverend Pickett earned his Master of Divinity degree from Duke University with a certificate in Baptist study. A lover of growth and development, he has also served as a minister interim at United Metropolitan Baptist Church in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, at the Covenant Presbyterian Church in Durham, North Carolina, and has served the New Mount Zion Baptist Church in Roxboro, North Carolina, as their pastor in residence. He served briefly as a community organizer in Brooklyn, New York, addressing issues of housing, affordability, policing, and community safety. It was at that time that our pastor, Reverend Philip, met him, and they struck up a friendship since then. Thereafter, he went on to serve as the Associate Minister of Stewardship and Development at the Riverside Church in the city of New York. Currently, Reverend Pickett serves as the campus minister for Christian diversity and ecumenical ministry at the University of Dayton in Dayton, Ohio, where he is also pursuing his PhD in educational leadership with a concentration in higher education administration. So we give him a Bethany welcome with open arms. We give God thanks for this servant whose mantra is, I will go, Lord, wherever you lead me. I will hold your people in my hands. So we give God thanks for sending his son, and we welcome you, Reverend Pickett, as you bring us a powerful word from the throne of God this morning. At this time, we're going to call on Sister Dominique Dorte to bring us the hymn of preparation, Order My Step in Your Word. Dominique Duarte, hymn of preparation, Order My Step in Your Word.
Order my steps in your word, dear Lord. Lead me, guide me every day. Send your anointing, Father, I pray. Order my steps in your word. Please order my steps in your word. Humbly I ask thee, teach me your will. While you are working, help me be still. Satan is busy, God is real. Order my steps in your word. Please order my steps in your word. Right on my tongue, let my words edify. Let the words of my mouth be acceptable in thy sight. Take charge of my thoughts, both day and night. Please order my steps in your word. Please order my steps in your word. I want to walk worthy, my calling to fulfill. Please order my steps, Lord, and I'll do your blessed will. The world is ever changing, but you are still the same. If you order my steps, I'll praise your name. Order my steps in your word. Order my tongue in your word. Guide my feet in your word. Wash my heart in your word. Show me how to walk in your word. Show me how to talk in your word. Provide me a brand new song to sing. Show me how to let your praises ring in your word.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, amen, amen. Order my steps in your word.
Amen.
We know the next voice you're going to hear is Reverend Dustin Pickett.
Amen. Amen. Can you all hear me well?
Amen. Yes, yes.
Order my steps in your word. Sister, thank you for that beautiful rendition of that. If you all give me, just let me adjust one thing, and I'm going to give me 1 second. I just want to make sure that you all hear me well. Perfect.
You're loud and clear.
Amen. This new way of doing things, we're adjusting and so grateful for it. I'm so glad for the opportunity to share with you again, Bethany. It has been a while, and so I am glad to be back here with you. Well, let's get into the word. First, let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this opportunity to join together in this space. We thank you for what you've already done through the reading of Scripture. Through the prayers that have gone forth, we thank you for what you have done through the beautiful singing of songs. And now we ask that in this moment of preaching, that you would endow me with a word that will give hope and assurance to your people for such a time as this. We thank you and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. The passage has already been read for you and I will not reread it. So I'm just going to jump right into this thing. This passage before us is filled with so much richness. There is a political crisis on the rise. Pharaoh has declared war on the Israelite people, and he is doing everything within his power to shut the people down. He's using fear tactics and xenophobia. You name it, he's doing it. And it would seem that the fate of the Israelite people is sealed. It isn't hard to look at this text and see the striking similarities into what we are facing now. Political crisis on the rise. It seems that people are under attack. And just when we thought the story was ending, there is a shift. Pharaoh is doing everything within his power to oppress the Israelite people, but the more that he tries to silence their voices, the more powerful they become. Pharaoh is the reason that the saying, "they tried to bury us, but they didn't realize we were seeds," even exist. Because every time Pharaoh tried to shut the Israelite people down, the Bible tells us that they increased in number and in power. The more he did, the greater they grew. And when Pharaoh's tactics did not work, he went to a new level of trifling. He realized that his plans wouldn't work without the assistance of others. And so the Bible tells us that he calls on the Hebrew midwives or the midwives of the Hebrews. And he tells them that when the children are birthed, that they are to kill the male children. Here, Shipra and Puah, two of the midwives, are instructed to do Pharaoh's dirty work and kill the male children. The plan should have worked under normal circumstances. It should have worked for several reasons, the main reason being power. The Hebrew midwives were near the bottom of the power hierarchy in relation to that of Pharaoh. Their job was to do as Pharaoh said. And so if they were operating under normal rules of law, they would have done just as they were instructed. However, we learn in Exodus 1:17 that there is a major difference in how the midwives operate. The scripture tells us that the midwives feared God. Their fear of God is important to note because it reveals to us one important thing. It lets us know that although Pharaoh exercised power over them, he was not the source of power within them. And so the midwives decided to enter into the risky business of what Reverend Dr. Nichelle Guidry calls subverting the system. The midwives worked to ensure that the male-born children would, in fact, live. This is risky business. It is risky business because the midwives are directly disobeying the instructions from Pharaoh. The business is risky because it would mean that their position to power is threatened. The business is risky because it would mean that their lives and livelihood are threatened. This is risky business. And yet the midwives decide within themselves that the business is worth the risk. I applaud Shipra and Pua because many people, when threatened with the danger of changing systems, find themselves at a standstill. Many people weigh the risk factors associated with radical change and decide that they are not up for the task. And I must note that the decision of Shipra and Pua is not only risky, but it is nuanced. They were both barren women, which means that they did not have to think about their own children's safety if they disobeyed instructions from Pharaoh and were met with harsh consequences. They mainly had to worry about themselves, and so although it did not make the decision easier, it may have lightened the load just a little bit. I must also note that I appreciate the midwives' decision to use their proximity to power to subvert the system, while also noting that this is not something that everybody can or will do. But it was Shipra and Pua's decision to take risk and lift their voices that would allow their names to be recorded in the canon of history. It was Shipra and Pua's decision to take risk that would ensure that a generation of Israelite children would continue to live, grow, and flourish. This is important to note, people, because Shipra and Pua were not the only midwives in Egypt. They are only the ones who lifted their voices in their text. More than likely, they are a part of a larger network, and I love the fact that they get the spotlight because when everybody else was silenced, Shipra and Pua decided to lift their voices and say to Pharaoh, "We will not do this." And they were sneaky in how they did it. They knew that if they were going to win this fight, that they had to have an underground railroad experience. They knew that they could not put everything out on the forefront. And so Shipra and Pua work under the ground to ensure that the Israelite children can live. I don't know why the others decided not to speak up, and that isn't where I wish to place my focus today, because I am glad that there are those who decide to lift their voices on behalf of those who are oppressed, no matter what the consequences may be. I'm glad that there are individuals who will decide to speak truth to power, even if it means that the power or powers will come crushing down on them. And so the question becomes, even with the nuances that I name, who is willing to speak up? Who is willing, in the words of our now ancestor John Lewis, to get into good trouble? That is the risk of it all. You know, as I read this text, it came to my attention that with all of the oppression happening in Exodus, with all that the children of Israel are faced with by the political systems that attempted to silence and kill them, it is not until the end of this particular text that we see God's active presence. At first, I was disturbed. I was disturbed because, like many, I wondered where God was. God, what are you doing when there is calamity all around? I wondered, what is God doing in the face of oppression? God, where are you when your people are being killed and are living under the threat of state-sanctioned violence? I wondered what many people wonder today. God, where are you when COVID-19 is running rampant and everything around us has changed? God, where are you when we black and brown people continue to be gunned down unjustly in the streets? God, where are you when people are living paycheck to paycheck? God, where are you when human trafficking is at an all-time high? God, where are you when our churches are more concerned with politics than they are people? God, where are you? At first glance, I said, it seemed as if God was not moving in the text, but I'm so glad that I did not stop reading there. I continued to read, Bethany, and I got the answer that I was looking for. I took a different look at the text. I changed my perspective, and in doing so, I realized that we actually see God moving the entire time. To say that God is not actively present or moving until Exodus 1:20 is to say that God is not present within Shipra and Pua. And what I realize is that God is moving because they are moving. God is working because they are working. And so the question then becomes in moments of trial and tribulation, not where is God, but where are we? What are we doing to change the circumstances around us? What are we doing to advocate and fight on the behalf of those who find themselves in situation worse than ours? If we are God's creation, and if we bear the likeness and goodness of God, then we are called to get in to good trouble. That is God's plan. We are called to stand up in moments where others are being oppressed. We are called to do the work of justice. This is how we see God at work. And so if you are one of those people who look around your neighborhood and wonder, when will things change? Beloved, the answer is things will change when you decide to change them. If you are one of those people who are wondering, what is Bethany doing? When will we do more? The answer is Bethany will change. Bethany will do more when you decide to get involved. We are the ones that we've been waiting for. God is at work through what we decide to do within our and with our proximity to power. God is at work through what we decide to do with our lives. God is at work through how we decide to get into good trouble. And I can hear the words of the prophet asking, Lord, what is my requirement? And I hear God responding to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. If you want to see God working through moments of crisis, you have to get to work. Shipra and Pua feared God, which meant they listened to and heeded God's instructions. It meant that they respected God enough to live a life that exemplified God's goodness and care for humanity. Because I've said it once and I'll say it again, you cannot say that you love God and not care for God's people. And with the fear that they had for God in their hearts, they decided to do something that would change not only their community in the present moment, but the course of history. And that is why we celebrate those individuals who risked their lives to get in to good trouble, because we realize that they put their lives at risk when there were other alternatives. And yet they felt God calling them to speak up and speak out for those whose voices were oppressed. Sometimes that meant speaking up for themselves and their communities. And sometimes it means speaking up for others. But all in all, they realized that if they did not speak up, their silence would do nothing to show disapproval. And I am glad that God is moving in this text, even when it shows up in ways that we don't imagine. I am glad that Shipra and Pua decided to be the hands, feet, and mouth of God. I am glad that they decided to get into good trouble because their work helped to change history. So today I want to give thanks for the Shipras and Puas of our generation and generations past. I want to give thanks for individuals who have decided and decide to get into good trouble because they realize that that is God's plan. I give thanks for John Lewis and James Baldwin and Fannie Lou Hamer and Prathia Hall and Coretta Scott King and Martin Luther King Jr. and Stokely Carmichael and Asada Shakur and Mother Teresa and Gustavo Gutierrez and Nelson Mandela and Nina Simone and Harriet Tubman and Marcus Garvey. I give thanks for Alicia Garza and Patrice Cullors and Opal Tometi. I give thanks for Tarana Burke and I give thanks for Ella Baker and Merle Evers Williams. I give thanks for Nanny Helen Burrows and Claudette Coven. I give thanks for Angela Davis and Erica Garner. I give thanks for Audre Lorde and Bree Newsom. I give thanks for the mothers and fathers and grandmothers and aunts and uncles and deacons and trustees and pastors who realized the need to be a village for so many children, even those who weren't their own. I give thanks for the countless individuals who decide to put their prayer into action and walk by faith, working to ensure justice and liberation for all God's people. I give thanks for those who, like Shifra and who would decide that they will enter risky, dangerous business and get into good trouble because they realize that they are the embodiment of God. They realize that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, of power, and a sound mind. And that means that good trouble is always necessary. It means that the liberation of God's people is always expedient. It means that we have work to do. We are not fearful of what the political crisis may be. We are not fearful of what is happening around us because we know that greater is he that is within us than he that is in the world. I am grateful for people who decide to stand up against the powers that be and say, we will not be moved like a tree planted by the water. We will not be moved because we are the church. And like Peter, God has built the church on a rock, and we will not be moved. The gates of hell shall not prevail against us. I'm grateful today for people who decided to go against what systems and structure said and to work on behalf of the oppressed, to work on behalf of the poor. Beloved, you know I'm Baptist, and so I'm grateful today. I'm grateful for a man by the name of Jesus who came through 40 and two generations and decided to get into good trouble. When the Pharisees and the Sadducees came against him, he kept working. When they told him to be silent, he said, if I'm silent, the rocks will cry out. I'm grateful for a man by the name of Jesus who gives us an example of how to get into good trouble, no matter what the circumstances seem like, no matter what the situation seemed like. Beloved, we have an example not only through Shipra and Pua in the Old Testament, but we have an example through Jesus in the New Testament that shows us time and time again, if we say that we are followers of Jesus Christ, it means that we have to put our bodies on the line and get into good trouble. And so today, I encourage you as you move throughout the rest of your week to examine what is going on around you. Look at what is happening in your communities. Look at what is happening near and around you and decide that you will not stop until you see justice come down like rivers of water. Don't stop until you decide to put your body on the line and get into good trouble, because Bethany, that is God's plan. God bless you.
Amen. 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 Reverend, we give God thanks for the word that you brought forth. We know that as a church, we will not be moved. We will join with others and give good trouble, because God is looking at us. And we thank God that he has raised up men and women that can follow in the path of those who have gone before us. So we thank you so much for your message. And as a church, we will continue to remind everyone, as we move towards November, check on your friends, check on your families and remind them that they ought to register to vote. Register to vote. So we would exercise the right that so much who have gone ahead of us has given good trouble so that we can do that later. Hallelujah. So we thank God for Reverend and the message, giving good trouble, and it's always in God's plan. So we're going to ask now Dominique Dorte to come and do the sermon response or hear our prayer. Sorry. Grace alone.
Every promise we can make, every prayer and step of faith, every difference we have made is only by His grace. Grace alone, which God supplies. Strength unknown, He will provide. Christ in us, our cornerstone. We will go forth in grace alone.
Amen. And as we continue, we want to bring before the throne room of grace the prayer for the people. Heavenly Father, unto you we come this day. We thank you for the word that went forth. We thank you that lives are being changed, healed, and transformed. We thank you that we can call on the name of Jesus, because your word tells us that we ought to cast all our cares unto you, because you care it for us. And God, you remind us that we need to pray about everything. So this day we come knocking on heaven's door as we pray, Lord God, that you would give us a fresh download of your grace and your mercy. God, we lift up before your throne room of grace, oh God, all those who are sick and afflicted. God, we lift up in particular Janet Cummins and Sister Simon. God, your word tells us, oh God, that you give us the power to heal. So right now, Lord God, we pray for Janet and we pray for Sister Cummins and anyone in the Bethany family who is sick and afflicted. God, we ask that right now that you would heal them from the very crown of their head to the sole of their feet. Lord, you tell us in the word, Lord God, that you bore all diseases and all infirmities, and by your stripes we were healed, Lord God. So we claim that healing power right now in the name of Jesus. God, we ask that you would visit Janet and that you would visit Sister Simon, Lord God. Lord God, we know that you are God Emmanuel. You are here, you are there, and you are everywhere, Lord God. We know that you are a mighty healer. And you are a great physician. So we ask, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that you would touch their organs, oh God. Oh God, that you would regulate every blood flow, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, if there is anything that is not good, Lord God, in our sisters, Lord God, we ask that you would remove it and replace it with what is very good. God, we stand on your word that says, oh God, if we follow your word, Lord God, and your commandments, oh God, you say you would bless our bread and you would bless our water and you would remove from among us sickness. So God, we stand on in the gap, Lord God, for Sister Janet and Sister Simon. Lord, your word in Jeremiah says above all, oh God, that they would be in good health and they would prosper. So God, we commit them into your hands, oh God, and we say, have your way, Lord God. Lord God, we ask, oh God, even right now, Lord God, that you would visit those who are taking care of them, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, for every healthcare worker, Lord God, every doctor, Lord God, every nurse, oh God, every surgeon, Lord God, every person that works in the laundry in the hospital, Lord God. Oh God, every worker in the hospital, Lord God, we pray that you would put a hedge of protection around them, Lord God. And most of all, God, we are praying that you would give them hearts of compassion, oh God, and that you would give them your wisdom, Lord God. We know that you are a miracle working God. So this day, Lord God, as we stand in the gap as a community, Lord God, we are believing you, Lord God, for a miracle of healing in the name of Jesus. God, we know that your word says when we call upon the name of Jesus, everything on the earth, under the earth, and on the earth has to bow, Lord God. So we claim the healing power right now in the name of Jesus. And God, we continue to draw the circle, Lord God, as we bring before you our children. God, there is so much uncertainty, Lord God, when it comes to our children and their return back to school this fall. God, we bring every administrator. We bring the governors, oh God, especially the governor of this New York, Lord God. We bring the mayor, the school chancellors, Lord God. We bring the principals, Lord God. We bring the parents, oh God. We pray, Lord God, that you would bring them together, Lord God. And collectively, Lord God, they would come up with the best plan, Lord God, for our children, Lord God. Lord God, we know that you raise our children to be the head and not the tail, Lord God. Lord God, you said, Lord God, above all, that our children, Lord God, would grow and be successful. So we pray, Lord God, those in the administration, Lord God, would seek you, Lord God, when it comes to our children, Lord God. Lord God, we can't do it on our own. We don't know where to turn, Lord God. But God, your word tells us when we call upon your name, we shall be saved. So God, we are standing in the gap on behalf of our children, Lord God. Oh God, they are now and they're going to be in the future, Lord God. So we pray, Lord God, that you would give them wisdom, Lord God. And those who are making decisions, oh God, they would get wisdom. And God, we continue to draw the circle this morning, Lord God, as we pray for those who have lost their jobs. God, because of this COVID-19, Lord God, we have seen, Lord God, one of the worst financial crises that we have seen in our lifetime. But God, we bring before you, Lord God, every person in our church, in our community, and across this nation who have lost their jobs, oh God. We pray, Lord God, that you would provide for them all their needs according to your riches in glory. God, we ask that you would open doors for them, Lord God, that no man can close. God, we know on our own self we cannot do it, Lord God. But we know, Lord God, with you all things are possible. So God, even though it might look uncertain right now, Lord God, we pray, Lord God, that those who have lost their jobs would find new avenues, oh God. Oh God, that they would be able to pay their rent and their mortgages and their utility bills, Lord God. Lord, they wouldn't have to choose whether to pay for food or to pay for shelter, Lord God. We know that you are a mighty God. We know that you are the great I am, Lord God. So this morning we cancel every appointment of poverty. We cancel every appointment of depression and suppression, Lord God. We cancel every appointment of hindrance, Lord God. And we stand on your word that says you will provide our needs according to your riches in glory. And Heavenly Father, Lord God, you tell us to pray, Lord God. So we bring before you this nation. God, you remind us, if ever there was dirt on the land, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and change from our wicked ways, Lord God, You said that you would hear from heaven and that you would heal the land. So, Lord God, we know if ever this land of United States need healing, is today and is right now. So, God, we pull down every negative energy, Lord God. We dismantle every satanic scheme, Lord God. Every diabolical lie, oh God. We cancel it in the mighty name of Jesus. And God, we come, Lord God, because only you, Lord God, can shield and protect us. Lord God, we pray even right now, Lord God, for your truth, Lord God, to continue to feed your children. Because there is so much that is out there, Lord God. But in the name of Jesus, we thank you, oh God, for words that was delivered to us today. We thank you, oh God, that every week our pastor brings to us a powerful word, oh God. And every week, Lord God, she's teaching us the word of God. So God, we pray even right now as we learn, Lord God, we will be able to impart this unto those that we come into connection with. Lord, we pray, Lord God, for the president and the cabinet. Lord God, our prayer is that you would give them compassion and that you would give them a heart over your, just like your heart. God, we lift up our prayers this morning knowing that whatever we bind here on earth, Lord God, you're going to ratify in the heaven. So in the name of Jesus, we give you honor. We give you glory and we give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
And now we're going to ask for Brother Power to sing to us, O Lord, hear my prayer. Brother Power, O Lord, hear my prayer.
O Lord, hear my prayer. O Lord, hear my prayer. When I call, answer me. O Lord, hear my prayer. O Lord, hear my prayer. Come and listen to me. O Lord, hear my prayer. O Lord, hear my prayer. When I call, answer me. O Lord, hear my prayer. O Lord, hear my prayer. Come and listen to me. Would you come and listen to me?
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brother Power. And before we call on Dr. Anthony to do the stewardship moment, I want to make one slight correction to one of the announcements that was lifted up today. With regards to our Bible study, we will resume the following week, which is September the 2nd. Not the 9th, as I had said previously. Bible study will resume on September the 2nd. Sorry. Amen. And now I call on Dr. Anthony for our stewardship moment.
Stewardship involves trusting in the Lord and giving of yourself and your resources. A connection to God through prayer and meditation helps us to make these choices. It is a journey, step by step, to serving others with a sincere heart and a joy-filled spirit. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 through verse 7 states that the point is this, that the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. As you continue to prayerfully support our church, You can mail your tithes and offerings to the church using a check or a money order, or electronically, you can use PayPal by going to our website at BethanyUMCBK.org. That's BethanyUMCBK.org, and click on select a page and choose donation, tithes, and offerings. Or you can use Zelle. Send in to the email BethanyUnitedBKLYN@gmail.com. That's BethanyUnitedBKLYN@gmail.com. Thank you, and blessings to all.
Amen. Thank you, Dr. Anthony. And now for our prayer of dedication. O God, the earth is yours and the fullness thereof. All that we have belong to you. And if our stewardship is acceptable and pleasing in your sight, we pray your manifold blessing on it. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And now for our mission statement. As disciples of Jesus Christ, our mission is to be demonstrators of the gospel, teachers of his word, and hearers of his message. Thanks be to God. And now we're going to ask Yvonne Stewart Amor to do our closing hymn. He leadeth me, O blessed thou. Closing hymn, number 128.
He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O words with heavenly comfort fraught. What here I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, and he leadeth me. Sometimes mid scenes of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's bowers bloom, by water still or troubled sea, still 'tis his hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. Lord, I would place my hand in thine, nor ever murmur nor profane, content whatever lot I see, since it's my God that leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. And when my task on earth is done, when by thy grace the victor's won, in death's cold wave I will not flee, since God through Jordan leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. respectful for all I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me, by his own hand he leadeth me. Respectful for who I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Just remember that we are going to remain on Zoom to meet and greet. And we want to thank Reverend Pickett on behalf of our pastor and all of the members of Bethany for the powerful word that he brought forth today. Our prayer is that God would continue to order his step and to go ahead of him. So now we're going to call on Reverend Pickett to give us the benediction.
Bethany, thank you all again for having me. Please receive this benediction. Now may the mountains rise in praise. May the valleys bow in worship. May the trees sway in adoration. May the rivers overflow with exceeding joy. And may you, the people of God, always be reminded of your call to do good trouble, because that is God's plan. Go in peace. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Reverend Pickett.